让我们以热烈的掌声欢迎林会长。
Your Excellencies, women leaders, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Global Women Peace Network Taiwan inauguration. Before we start, I would like all of you to join with me a moment of silence in memory of a girl that was battered and killed in India. 请我们在开始之前静默片刻。来纪念在去年十二月被杀害、强暴的印度的女孩。It is indeed a great pleasure and honor for me to participate with you in this very significant event. We are fortunate in having with us so many distinguished group of VIPs. Our special welcome must go to those who have traveled great distance to be here. Please welcome our speaker today, Dr. Srirupa Mitra Chowdhury. She is the chairperson of Special Task Force on Rape, Trafficking, and Violence Against Women, and also the chairperson of Commission for Review of National Policy for Empowerment, and the chairperson of Independent Commission on Rape, Government of India. Also recently, she got an award, of our outstanding woman award. 今天的主讲人
Dr. Srirupa， 她不仅身为世界和平妇女会印度会长，还担任印度妇幼发展部主席及女性充权国家政策审查委员会主席，同时也是印度国家妇女委员会专责强暴、贩卖人口、性别暴力事务部门暨专案研究委员会主席。现在，让我们以最热烈的掌声欢迎今天的主讲人 Dr. Srirupa。
Pranam. Greetings in the morning. First of all, Dr. Hakja Hanmoon, the founder of Women's Federation for World Peace, who is in United States right now, and Dr. Lan Yan Moon, the international president of WFWP, who is also not with us physically, but as we always say, they are always with us in our spirit, in our heart, and in our soul. Dr. Hong, the special representative of True Mother, we address Dr. Hakja Hanmoon as True Mother, as the founder of the institution. I'm very glad to see you here. And we have my very, very favorite sister, Dr. Lily Lin, who is also the friend of the house, and she is the president of Asia of Women's Federation for World Peace. Your prayer for India and Nirbhaya will go a long way. In fact, it is my internal feeling that I want to share with you ever since December 2012, wherever I am traveling, including the CSW at the United Nations in New York. It's like a burden that I'm carrying with me all the time, the spirit of Nirbhaya. I'm glad that you have remembered her, and also with that the symbolic prayer that you have done is really, really touched my heart. Also, I have the great pleasure to have you, the president of the Universal Peace Federation, which is the umbrella organization of the WFWP. Without UPF, the existence of WFWP is incomplete. And I'm very happy, Dr. Po Ya Chang, you are here with us, and such a beautiful background that I learned about you, and I'm so grateful to God that you are with us. I'm happy with my Didi, my sister, who is the president of Thailand. Madam is here with us, and she's with me from the time that we have traveled to Songkhla in Thailand, in the South Thailand, where we had the big fight going on between the Muslims and the Buddhists. And we, all women of the world, we gathered there to seek peace, solidarity, and support from them. I'm very happy to have with us the president of Taiwan, Madam, and your beautiful daughter, the legislator of Taiwan, and also with this, my brother from India, Mr. Rawat, who is the Director General of the India-Taipei Association in the diplomatic mission here. We had a great dinner with him yesterday night, with his wife and with the family. And all the sisters and brothers who are sitting here, some of you are judges and women leaders and legislators, and above all, you are the mother and you are the sister, and also my sister. I'm very, very, very honored to be here, because it's the mission of women and the mission to protect women and children which has brought me here. I'm traveling every day, every moment, not having any time to sit back in New Delhi. And these days it has become so difficult for me. Wherever I go, I am faced with questions that why India, such a large democracy, such a beautiful country with mountains, with nature, with tropical rain areas, and we have the religion of so many religions, so many castes, and so many beautiful conclaves of communities with us living together for thousands and thousands of years. And we are a country where we worship women. We call women Devi. And in our annual functions, annual religious celebrations, we have women deity, particularly from the region that I come. We have women as goddess whom we celebrate, whom we worship. We have small children. We have rituals in our country where young girls who have not attained puberty We worship them as idols, small, small little girls. We make them wear beautiful dresses like gods and goddesses and make them sit in a raised platform and we worship them. This is our country. India is not a country where we actually invite violence or we like to indulge in violence. We are a country, we love to have, you know, people from all over the world. And we have actually, like Taiwan, as you said, that here we really embrace immigrants from all over the world. We also have that kind of spirit in India. We often call that we have a diverse nature of the country, but the unity in that diversity is our strength. We are 1.3 billion population. Half of the population is women. And we have seen through the ages that our women have become the role models, not only in our freedom struggle, not only in the emancipation of women, but holding the man, holding the children as their better half and giving them moral support. That is the country. What has happened with Nirbhaya on 16th of December is not really the true representation of India. But then why, after Nirbhaya, one after the other, every day, we find 5 to 6 cases which are publicized in the newspaper where the women and girls have been battered, killed, raped. And let me share with you, like true sister, that when the rape happened of Nirbhaya, it's not really a rape, it's not a human rape. The gearbox of a bus was used for penetration. I just came when there is a young girl, 5-year-old. She was raped and still struggling for life in our hospital. A 5-year-old girl child. The doctors have taken out a bottle of hair oil of this size from her sexual organ. And she's fighting for her life. This type of vicious and murderous attempt on women and girls, what does it mean? I, as the chairperson of the Special Task Force on Rape, I, as the representative of the Women and Child Ministry of our government, I am very satisfied with our laws, with our rules, with our systems that the government of India has brought in the past 60 years of our independence. We have no dearth of legal framework. We have no dearth of sensitized police force. There are gaps, but not major ones. And we have a polity where at the grassroots, at the very, very ground level, we have 3 tiers of leadership. And 50% of those grassroots leadership are women by way of a law. In our polity, we have respect for women and 50% reservation in the municipal council of our towns and suburbs. Then why these women and girls who have been battered, killed, and so badly tortured? Is this a country of torture? I represent not only the government of India here, I also represent the Women's Federation for World Peace, the International Congress of Women, the National Institute for Gender Justice, and numerous NGOs who have kindly taken me on their board as the president or chairperson. So I represent the government, I also represent the non-government. And I also, in my own hands, rescue and rehabilitate women and girls who are destitute, who are homeless, abandoned, and raped. So from all representation, without hiding, and giving you the very frank submission that India is not a country where torture is accepted. We condemn violence. We come from the land of Mahatma Gandhi. And as you know, Mahatma Gandhi is respected as the father of the nation. As you know, the birthday of Mahatma Gandhi, the 2nd of October, is observed now as the United Nations International Day of Nonviolence and Peace. Therefore, I will not accept, I will not give this wrong view to this august gathering that India is the land of violence. It is not. Then the question is, why this violence? What has happened is also the truth. So what is the reason? What is the background? To my understanding, which I am carrying after doing thousands of deliberations and seminars and interaction with all different groups in our society, what I have learned, that we possibly, after the First World War, the Second World War, now we are into a Third World War, which is the moral and immoral continuum which we need to look at. I think what we need in India is the need of the world. There is a moral renaissance which is required. What I understand, that it is not the dearth of police and security and the systems and the governance in India which is lacking, but it is the forces in our society which is acting against the rule of nature. The rule of nature has taught us how to salvage man from the fallen man to the righteous man. If you go to any religious scripture, no matter whether it is Bible or it is Quran or it is Buddhism or it is Hindu scriptures, we have found that God has created human being in his own image. But if the man and the woman, if the humanity is not in the righteous path, if our mind is distorted, and if we do not have the balance between our body and mind, if our alignment is not correct, definitely we are going to falter. We are going to commit crimes. We say in the language of the UPF, in the language of the WFWP, we seek the body-mind alignment. A kind of vertical relation between the God and the parents and the mankind. I find in my analysis what has happened in India and what is happening in many parts of the world with women is because our relationships between man and woman is not going through a good time. We need to have a very, very cohesive, very, very harmonious relationship between man and woman in our society. When we talk of gender equality, we actually talk of good relationship. And beyond gender equality, we are talking about gender humility now. We found in India and many countries that the men and women both have gained the knowledge of rights. They have understood what is their role and responsibility, but yet they are not peaceful in their own life. Therefore, they are battling, they are fighting. As a result, there is no gender humility. So it's not gender equality which is the only way to achieve peace. If we do not have gender humility between us, then we will not be able to withstand each other. And if we cannot withstand each other, believe me, the children that we are going to produce in the course of our life, they are not going to be the children of love. They are going to be the children of storm. They are going to be the children of typhoon. And those children, when they go out in the society, you leave them after 18 years of their life as they become adult. They do not have the control. They do not have the control over their mind and body. The little boy of 17 years, who is an accused in this rape case in India, I went to analyze his psychosocial mindset. And I found that this little boy, when he was a 5 year old, he said, for 10 years of my life, I have seen sexual violence between my father and mother. In his testimonial to the government and police, he has stated that I have seen my father raping my mother every day. And when I became 14 year old, I have seen my mother going away from my father and meeting with 5 different men every day. And I saw my mother, how from a mother she became a prostitute. And when I became 17 year old, I wanted to visit the brothel houses. And that very day, on 16th of December, I was traveling in a bus. And when I was traveling in a bus, I saw this ghastly incident happening in front of my eyes. And I could not believe that I can also participate. And I did participate. And I have become an accused. So this testimonial to me, as a government representative, it shows that it is not that the boy was born as a criminal, but the boy was born out of the warring, battling parent. So the most important thing in our life is how to make our relationships correct, how to achieve a good husband-wife relationship, how to give birth to children of love, and how to show them the models of love. If we don't do that, if we just have relationships here and there and everywhere, and we give birth to children, then we don't have moral control over them. And what I feel today the women are facing is a kind of immorality, a kind of moral breakdown, the breakdown of our values. And that is why the assault is taking place in such a vicious manner. In India and from India, I am seeking a kind of moral renaissance. And how will it happen? It can only happen if we, in the first place, respect life, which is the manifesto of the Taipei Manifesto, prepared by Mrs. Lily Lin and her group. The first condition is we need to respect life. We need to respect the Mother Earth, the vibration which has brought us to this world. And we need to respect our relationship with our ancestors, the culture, the inheritance that they have given to us. And we need to respect the roots of our society. We cannot be rootless vagabonds. We cannot be rootless Yankees. We cannot be just a backpacker moving in the world. God has created us with a purpose. and the human sexuality having a purpose. It's not for enjoyment. It's not for pleasure. It's also joining us with the root of creation of human beings. And therefore, I feel in the process of development of our society, if we cannot have the respect for life and humanity and the respect for our culture and heritage, we will not exist as righteous men and women. And the most important thing in our existence, in our relationship with our Creator, the vertical relationship with our Creator, and the alignment of the body and mind. And if we can achieve that, then the next phase is going to be our integration of the social forces. When you and I know that we have a righteous attitude and a true philosophy and a principle and an attainment to establish a relationship, vertical relationship in our society, then I'm sure we can integrate all the social forces together. That is what the second manifesto says, that we need to have the social integration. And the third one is intergenerational partnership and cooperation. I come from the land of Rabindranath Tagore, the Nobel laureate, poet from our country, who said that if you want to attain peace and harmony in the society, in your life, then you have to respect that the life is like a river. It started with your grandfather and your great-grandfather and your grandmother, and it has been taken over by you, and it will be taken over by your children and your grandchildren. So it is not me and me and me, it is not you and you and you alone who exist in the society. We exist because they existed, and we exist because they will exist. So the intergenerational integration and cooperation between today's generation and the past generation and the younger generation is one of the main attempts that we should make to pass on our thoughts and our ideology to the new generation. I really respect Mrs. Lily Lin, who has been meeting me and always talking how to send, how to form delegation of young men and women, and how to send them as missionaries and the envoys of hope, not only to India, but the entire world. I really respect Dr. Hak Jahan Moon, who has been consciously sending, creating missionaries, young missionaries, and sending them to different parts of the world with the same value that we need to create good human beings. We need to create righteous principles, and we need to connect with our true parents, with our heavenly parents, and with our children. If the man, woman, and child together don't exist, then it is impossible for us to achieve the gender humility and therefore the gender equality. The discrimination will continue, the assault will continue, because we do not know how to affect each other. I am very deeply concerned about two social forces which have taken over half of our life, of our new generation. One is the internet sex revolution. I am finding that our children, children of the world, they are exposed to this beautiful IT revolution called internet. And through this internet revolution, which is the gateway, the window to their learning, they are also bombarded with a very, very organized industry of pornography, particularly from the Western societies. There is a very strong force and a very, very rich force with lot of money and investment. There are organized groups who are planning how to reach out to young men and women in the name of fashion, in the name of modernity, with the new forms of sex. And while they are doing that, they are bringing out in the name of sexual innovation, sexual novelty. They are bringing out stories and pictures and music and the words and vocabulary of not only man-woman relationship, but man and man relationship, woman and woman relationship, man and animal relationship. There is a huge revolution which is taking place silently, and they are invading our children's mind. And on the other hand, if you look at our religious leaders, our parents, our teachers, our educators, they are silent about sex. In one side, there is a bad sex revolution. On the other side, nobody is talking about absolute sex and good sex and the purpose of human sexuality in this world. So there is an imbalance which is taking place in our children's mind. Women's Federation for World Peace and the Universal Peace Federation, you will be pleased to know that we run a campaign, worldwide campaign, called Pure Love Campaign. We talk to small children going to the schools in every country that we should have a good life when we are student, when we are youth, and we should not have multiple relationships before our marriage. We talk to these children very openly what it means by good marriage, what it means by fidelity in marriage. And we try to plant the seed when they are very young, before they are spoiled. I seek from all of you that please join our Pure Love Alliance. Please join our Pure Love Campaign. Because we are going through a silent third world war, which is the war of immorality. And it is silently eating the humanity in us, the purity in us. And it is making our world impure. So the solution does not lie in having more and more police stations, more and more women police force, more and more fast-track courts. These are the requirement. If we have an air crash, we need ambulance. But we all should try that there should not be air crash. In order to achieve the purity in life, in order to maintain good relationships, in order to achieve peace in our society, we need to be peaceful. Our families have to be the true temple of peace and love. Our family has to be the primary school, the true primary school of peace and love. And then the peace will slowly come in our community, because the community is created by the families, by individuals. And beyond the community is the nation. Beyond the nation, it is the world. So the true story of peace lies in you, in your relationship with others, in your relationship with God, in your relationship with your parents, with your spouse, with your children. In India, I'm going to start a very special Institute of Marriage and Family, and I have been requesting the government of India to participate. And we wish to go from house to house, from family to family, from child to child, and connect like a beautiful garland. Without peace in you, without peace in your family, without peace in your relationship, we cannot achieve community peace. Forget about the world peace. And the story of peace lies in our family. And the incident of Nirbhaya, that 16 December in India, is not the story about law, is not the story about the failure of the governance of either the government of India or the women's movement. It is the failure of our moral system. And I wish that through this forum and the GWPN, of which I am also a partner and participant, I think that we can do a difference. I wish you luck, Mrs. Lily Lin, who is really a leader of Asia for us. And I look forward to the blessings of God. And Dr. Hong, please carry my words to Mother Moon, that we really, really want a moral renaissance, a moral movement to take place, which will not just talk about gender equality, it will talk about brotherhood, sisterhood, and gender humility. Thank you very much.
非常感谢印度会长为我们带来非常精彩的演说以及动容的分享。接下来我们有十分钟的交流讨论时间。由于时间有限，请各位在介绍完您的单位后回应或提问。每人以一分钟为限。在贵宾前方桌上备有发言按钮，欢迎与会贵宾提出相关问题，再请印度会长回应分享或进一步说明。想法有没有把它想要连接起来？ 我想这样子可能会让更多的人知道和平跟妇女之间还有网络之间的整个连结。谢谢。
Very interesting first question. Yes. Yes, I'm married for last 25 years with my husband, who is part of the Indian civil service, Indian administrative service. He works for the government of India. And I have four children, three daughters and one son. My daughters are named after the title of dance drama of Rabindranath Tagore. They are called Chitrangada, Krishnakali and Antardhwani. And my son is Rudraksh, which I wear. This is Rudraksh. This is from the tree. This is a holy symbol of India. And if you say that whether you have a family and children, I also like to share that personally I have set up many foundations in India. Out of that, I run 20 shelter homes for survivors of rape and acid attack since last 22 years. And 11 of them are situated in New Delhi. In New Delhi, I have about 1,000 women living in these 11 shelter homes, and they are rescued from very, very tough circumstance by police or judiciary, and they are brought into the shelter home, and they are given free food, clothes, living, medical facility, and all these things. And now there are 20 centers in India like that. And the second question that you asked, that how to connect the network. I think that WFWP, which exists in 194 countries through the UPF network, is already a very, very strong network of individuals and organizations and countries. And if you go through those, I'm sure that you will see the connectivity very strong. Thank you.
He has also mentioned that in India, perhaps, in the future, he will also have to invite many people to the GWPN. 好，不晓得还有没有什么问题。
Hello, I'm Caroline Zhou from TIWC. Mr. Sarupa's speech is quite impressed me, and I would like to have some questions. Because I think the you are talking about respect between the women and the men, but I think it's very important is about education. So how do you work with your government for the elementary school in this part? And the second question is, I think the media is also very important part to inform people in India, because I know your this kind of industry is quite popular. So how do you co-work with your media in this part? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. You are right. The most important need of the day is to educate the children and also the members of the society. But as I said again and again, that the education system, the schools, that come as the secondary level of education. Our primary education about love and peace and relationship and good life begins at our home. So for me, the most important thing is how to build a good home, how to build a peaceful temple at our own home. And from there, the children go to school. Every day in India, I find that children who have come from the home to school, the many children, 30% children in a classroom, they have actually come without combing their hair, without brushing their teeth properly, without wearing a proper uniform. So when I go and ask them, what happened this morning? You didn't have breakfast? The child starts crying. Mother was crying at home. Father was not okay. Last night was not good. They talk of domestic violence. We find, you can make out from the school, from the classroom, the children who are coming contented, happy, smiling, well-combed, well-maintained, well-groomed. The parents have done a lot of work on them. So when they come to class, they are in a receptive mode. You are able to teach them. But if they are coming from broken homes, broken ideology, broken relationship, they are not able to sit properly. They are tense. So for me, the school, beginning to talk in the school, already the teachers are doing hard work. We have very good curriculum already in the schools. Children are also working very hard. They are becoming ambitious, more ambitious than our generation to learn. But the background from where they are coming and where they are going to, a home is not just a home. It is a home from where you start your day and where you go back. So that home has to be very, very peaceful. So when we talk about education, I am talking of education not in terms of textbook reading. Reading in the textbook that be moral, don't be immoral, rules, do's and don'ts don't work. If in your real life you are battered, you are a survivor, you are a victim, a child is a victim of the mother and father's violence, which is the most disturbing thing. So I think the education should begin at home, and education should begin for the families and parents. And then the education will go well with the children. Thank you.
好，那我们时间的关系就到这个地方哈，谢谢。谢谢，好吗？